Hey everybody, this is Keith Bloom from Manhattan Prep, and we are tackling a GMAT question. So take 2 minutes and good luck. All right, so this question, kind of an interesting one. I like this a lot. They actually set the stage. They give us an example, the integer 6, and what they explain to us is 6 has an interesting property in that it's the product of 2 consecutive integers, and they nicely write that out for us, and it's also the product of 3 consecutive integers. And what they go on to ask is, what's the next integer greater than 6 that has this property? So this is something where there could be a temptation to kind of start to work our way up and think, well, there's 6. So what would be another good candidate? What's the next one up? But this is where I think it is reinforced how important it is to make sure that you look at the answer choices and use them to your advantage. That's one of the big things about the GMAT. We have answer choices we can work with. And because they want the next integer greater, our hand is basically forced in that we want to work from A on down to E. Also, something to think about strategically on this, the writers know they're basically tasking us with a fair amount of factoring. When they do it, it would really arguably be unfair to make E the correct answer here. If you're methodical in your process and your process is efficient, you should be able to answer a GMAT question in around 2 minutes, sometimes a little bit longer, but nonetheless. So I think you could, with good reason, think it's probably not gonna be D or E in this. And we're gonna find that this will bear fruit. This is how it's gonna play out. And we've got another thing that actually falls in our favor in that when you stop and think about what they're asking of us, we want to look for the next number that has 2 consecutive integers that make it up and 3 consecutive integers multiplied together that make it up. And it turns out when that happens, notice in each one of these that one of the factors is even, in this case, 2 both times. Well, that has to be the case, right? Because when you think about consecutive numbers, every other one of them is even, right? 2, 4, 6. And so we know then that the number that we're going to give them, the correct answer actually has to be an even number. So we don't even need to check 153. Awesome. So we're going to check 210. You want to make sure that factoring numbers is something that is very comfortable for you. Procedurally, I like to start with the units digit, also thought of as the ones digit. And if it has a 0 or 5, it's got a 0 here, I'm going to factor out a 10 or a 5. In this case, like I said, with the 0, it's going to be 10. So I know 210 is the same as 21 times 10. 10 factors into 2 and 5. An interesting thing about numbers that can be divided by 3 or have a factor of 3, the sum of their digits is divisible by 3. So I know without doing any work that 123 is divisible by 3 because 1 plus 2 plus 3 is 6. 6 is divisible by 3. So I know that 3 works. 21 is 3 times 7. So as I have now factored 210 into its primes, I think it's helpful for me, especially the what they're asking of us, is to actually arrange these in ascending order. So now I have my prime factors arranged, and I'm looking for getting 2 consecutive integers. So if I'm going to do that, to me, what we'll need to do is combine the middle 2 and the outside 2, meaning the smallest and the largest, and then the 2 that are in the middle to see if they're one away, if they're consecutive. And they are, right? 2 times 7 is 14 and 3 times 5 is 15. So we have met the first condition that we have two consecutive integers. Well, now we're looking for the final payoff and to see if 3 in a row works. And this is a case where we see a space between 5 and 7. If this is going to work for the win, can we get a 6? And it turns out we absolutely can. 2 times 3 takes us to the promised land. And it also is such that 5 times 6 times 7 also is 210. So when we see a problem like this, when they're asking for like the next largest number from something they've given us, recognize that you're going to need to work from answer choice A down to E. Also expect that you'll be able to eliminate some answer choices, probably because of a property, as we were able to do here with answer choice A. And also that as a big a pain as GMAT questions are, they are fair. They can be sneaky. They set traps for us, but they're not going to ask us a question that's constructed in such a way where we just have to do so much computation that it's not reasonable to be able to do it in a little bit over 2 minutes.
Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight problems from Manhattan Prep and leave us a comment telling us how you solved the problem. Happy studying!